In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. Through the grace of God, we will study tonight chapter 13 from the book of Acts, from verse 26 to the end of the chapter. Chapter 13 explains to us part of the second missionary trip of St. Paul. Specifically, his ministry in Antioch, Pisidia, Antioch of Pisidia. St. Paul went to the synagogue of Antioch, Pisidia, and he started to preach to them about the Lord Jesus Christ. And in order to preach about the Lord Jesus Christ, he started by giving a summary of the history of Israel. And he came until he explained the ministry of John the Baptist, who came as a forerunner to prepare the way before the Lord Jesus Christ. And he concluded verse 25 by the words of John the Baptist when he said, I am not he, I am not the Messiah, but behold, there comes one after me, the sandals of whose feet I am not worthy to loose. Then actually, we will continue from verse 26, the rest of his speech at the synagogue at the city of Antioch of Pisidia. And Antioch of Pisidia is different than Antioch in Syria. Antioch Pisidia is part of Asia Minor, which now is part of Turkey. So it's different than Antioch of Syria. Verse 26. Men and brethren, sons of the family of Abraham, and those among you who fear God, to you the word of this salvation has been sent. In the synagogue, the multitude who listened to the preaching of Saint Paul were two groups. One group, the Jewish people who are living now in Antioch of Pisidia. But the other group is the Gentiles. That's why St. Paul is addressing both groups. When he said, men and brethren, sons of the family of Abraham, sons of the family of Abraham, here he is addressing the Jews who are living in Antioch of Pisidia. And those among you who fear God, now he is addressing the Gentiles who came also to listen to the preaching of St. Paul. And then he said to both groups, to you, the word of this salvation has been sent. Now St. Paul is emphasizing that the word of salvation is not only sent to the chosen people of Israel, but also to the Gentiles as well. And as you see at the end of this chapter, how when the Jews heard the words of St. Paul, that the salvation is also for the Gentiles, they became very jealous. And actually, they expelled them from the city and drove them out, because in their mind, the Messiah would come only to Israel, not to any other nation. Verse 27, for those who dwell in Jerusalem and their rulers, because they did not know him, nor even the voices of the prophets, which are read every Sabbath, have fulfilled them in condemning him. Now, St. Paul is speaking about how the Lord Jesus Christ was condemned to death. was condemned to death actually by the rulers of the Jews, by the chief priests of the Jews. And although they had the prophecies, but they were blind. And without knowing, by condemning the Lord Jesus Christ, actually they were fulfilling these prophecies. They did not know that he is the Messiah. And they wanted to get rid of him, to kill him, without realizing that by rejecting him and by killing him, actually they are fulfilling the prophecies that are written about him in the Old Testament. That's what St. Paul said here. Those who dwell in Jerusalem, the rulers and the chief priests, they did not know him. They did not accept him. They did not receive him. He came to his own, but his own rejected him. And even they did not know the voices of the prophecy, of the prophets which are read every Sabbath. They used to go to the temple every Sabbath and to hear the prophecies, but they were blind. They couldn't understand these prophecies. And actually, without realizing, they have fulfilled the prophecies in condemning him. Verse 28. And though they found no cause for death in him, they asked Pilate that he should be put to death. Do you remember when Pontius Pilate washed his hand and he said, I don't find any fault in this man? And actually, they cried and said, crucify him, crucify him. They were fulfilling actually how the Passover lamb was chosen. Because for the Passover lamb, in order to be offered, he has to be without blemish. And if the Passover lamb is without blemish, then the high priest will approve the slaying of the Passover lamb. And this is exactly what happened with the Lord Jesus Christ. When actually after Pilate and Herod examined him, and after the high priest examined him, they found him without blemish. They found him without fault. And by saying, crucify him, crucifying him, actually, they testified that he is the Passover lamb. Because now he is without blemish, that's why he will be offered as the Passover lamb. Though they found no cause for death in him, they asked Pilate that he should be put to death. Verse 29. Now, when they had fulfilled all that was written concerning him, they fulfilled the crucifixion, as it is written in Psalm 22 and also in Isaiah 53. After they fulfilled all these prophecies in the Old Testament, they took him down from the tree. The tree is the cross, because the wood of the cross was taken from a tree, and laid him in a tomb. And again, there are many prophecies about the Lord Jesus Christ was buried in a tomb. And now St. Paul will explain these prophecies, whether about David, who said this in one of his Psalms, or about the Lord Jesus Christ. So they took him in the 11th hour from the tree of the cross and buried him in a tomb. Verse 30, but God raised him from the dead. And when actually we read about the resurrection, you will find sometimes it is said God the Father raised the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. In other passages, you will find that the Holy Spirit raised the Lord Jesus Christ from the dead. And in other passages, you will find that he rose by himself from the dead. So actually, resurrection is the work of the Holy Trinity. It's the work of the Holy Trinity. That's why many verses have the Father raised the Son, like this verse. In other verses, he rose by himself, and in other verses, the Holy Spirit raised him. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ was proved by the eyewitnesses, by the testimony of the eyewitnesses. That's why in verse 31 he said, he was seen for many days. So it was not only once. If it's once, maybe we can say just people, yani, they imagined that they saw him. But actually, he was seen for many days, and he ate with them on the Sea of Tiberias. And one time he appeared to more than 500 persons together. And as St. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, most of them were alive when he wrote his letter to 1 Corinthians. So this couldn't be just imagination. The resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ is reality. He was seen for many days by those who came up with him from Galilee to Jerusalem. Here he is speaking about the apostles, who are his witnesses to the people. And this was the main message that the apostle preached to the people, that we were eyewitnesses of his resurrection. We saw him after his death. We saw him after his resurrection. We touched him. We ate with him. So this resurrection is not just an imagination, but a real event. Verse 32, why he is saying all of this? Why God sent his son to the world? And why the son was crucified? And why he died? And why he was buried? And why he rose from the dead? Why all of that? Here is the answer in verse 32. And we declare to you glad tidings, the good news, that promise which was made to the fathers. Now we are declared to you the glad tidings, the good news, that the promise that God made to Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, the promise that God made to David, the promise that God made actually to Adam and Eve, that the offspring of the woman will crush the head of the serpent, this is fulfilled. And this salvation is for us to enjoy the salvation, to set us free from the enmity of the devil. And now we can enjoy this salvation and we can enjoy the eternal inheritance. God has fulfilled this for us. God has fulfilled this for us. God didn't need all of this, as we say in St. Gregory liturgy. You are not in need of my service, but I am in need for your lordship. So God has fulfilled this salvation for us, their children, the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Either the children, the descendant of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, like the Jews, or the spiritual children, like the Gentiles. As the Lord Jesus Christ himself said, if you do the works of Abraham, then you are the children of Abraham. So yes, we are not the descendant of Abraham, but we are his spiritual children. So God has fulfilled this for us, their children. In that, he has raised up Jesus. Because if the Lord Jesus died and he did not rise, then there is no salvation. St. Paul said, if Jesus Christ did not rise from the dead, then you are still in your sins. There is no salvation. But the Lord Jesus conquered death. By his death, he abolished the power of death. So in him, we can abolish the power of death. And in him, we can live eternally. That's why he said, in that he has raised up Jesus, as it is also written in the second Psalm. What's written in the second Psalm? St. Paul here is quoting, you are my son, today I have begotten you. And maybe this psalm in our mind is about the incarnation. And actually in the Feast of Nativity, the psalm of the gospel is, you are my son, today I have begotten you. But actually, St. Paul now is using this psalm about the resurrection. How St. Paul used this psalm, you are my son, this day I have begotten you, how he is using this as a psalm of resurrection. And this psalm, actually, Psalm 2, verse 7. The answer, you will find it in Romans chapter 1, verse 4. Romans chapter 1, verse 4. He said, St. Paul, in Romans 1, 4, he, the Lord Jesus Christ, was declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. So, how we became so sure that Jesus is the Son of God? How we became so confident that Jesus Christ is the second hypostasis, is the hypostasis of the Son of God? St. Paul in Romans chapter 1, verse 4, he said, he was declared to be the Son of God by power, with power, by the resurrection from the dead. So as if by the resurrection, now his sonship of the Father declared to everybody. That's why, as if the Lord, when he said on the mouth of David, you are my son, today I have begotten you, actually this was declared and revealed to everybody on the day of resurrection. And by the way, the word today is not about a specific day, but this is actually the eternal day, the day that started from before all ages and has no end. Because the Son is begotten from the Father, and this actually filiation, the process of the Son is begotten from the Father, we call it filiation, this process is a continuous process. It started from the before the ages and has no end. It's eternal. Like how the rays or the beams of light come from the sun. So it's a continuous process. So the birth of the Son from the Father is a continuous process. So the word today is not about a specific day, 24 hours, no. This today is the day of eternity, has no beginning and has no end. Verse 34, and that he raised him from the dead, no more to return to corruption. He has spoken thus. St. Paul, when he spoke about the Lord Jesus Christ, he said he is the first fruit of the departed, those who were raised from dead. But actually, we have Lazarus was raised from dead before the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the daughter of Jairus was raised from the dead before the Lord Jesus Christ. We have the son of the widow at the city of Nain. Also, he was raised from the dead before the Lord Jesus Christ. So how come St. Paul refers to the Lord Jesus Christ as the first fruit of the departed? Now we know three persons at least were risen from the dead before him. And in the Old Testament, we have other three persons. One was raised by Elijah, and two by Elisha. So why St. Paul calling the Lord Jesus Christ the first fruit of the departed? The answer is in this verse. Because the Lord Jesus Christ did not die again. And his body did not see corruption like any regular human being. Lazarus died again and his body saw corruption. But the Lord Jesus Christ rose from the dead and never, even during these 3 days, his body never saw corruption. And that's why actually it's interesting observation. When Lazarus came out from the tomb, he came with what? With the grave clothes on him. But when the Lord Jesus Christ came out from the tomb, he left the grave clothes in the tomb. Why? Because Lazarus was raised with a mortal body, a body that will die again, a body that will see corruption. But the Lord Jesus Christ risen with the glorified body, and his body did not see corruption. And now, actually, he is quoting another verse. I will give you the sure mercies of David. I will give you the sure mercies of David. What he meant by the sure mercies of David? The sure mercies of David means the mercies that was promised to David. The mercies that was promised to David. We can read this in Isaiah 55, verse 3. I will make with you eternal covenant, the sure mercies of David. And also in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 10. So these are two references about the sure mercies of David. But what is the sure mercies of David? What God has promised David? What God has promised David? St. Paul says in verse 35, therefore he also says in another psalm, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption. So if this promise was given to David or to the son of David, St. Paul answers and says, we have the tomb of David here and his body, so corruption. So this verse is not about David. This verse is about the son of David, the Messiah who will come from the offspring of David. That's why in verse 36 he said, for David, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep, died, was buried with his fathers, and saw corruption. And here I like the word served God. Actually, when we live our life here on earth, we are in a mission. And our life, like we are serving God. We are steward. And when we are born, God gives each one of us a certain responsibility. And actually, whether when we are working or we are raising our children or serving in the church, whatever capacity, serving God is not just when you serve in the church, but all what you do in your life, it is service for God. That's why he said, after he had served his own generation by the will of God, according to the will of God. Because when we live our life, we are steward. We are not the owners. So if we are a steward, we should conduct our life according to his will. What do you want me to do? How you want me to conduct my life? How you want me to fulfill this responsibility? It is not our own will, because we are not the owners, but we are just a steward. And St. Paul, because he understood this, so he didn't say when David died or when he finished his mission or his responsibility. He said when he served his own generation by the will of God, fell asleep and was buried with his fathers and saw corruption. So because David saw corruption, then this verse, you will not allow your Holy One to see corruption, definitely is not about David. This verse is not about David. And actually, the same verse was quoted by St. Peter in his sermon on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, the same verse. Then about whom this verse is, verse 37, but he whom God raised up saw no corruption. He, Jesus. So Paul here is telling us This verse is about the Lord Jesus Christ, because he did not see corruption, neither in the 3 days that he was in the tomb, nor after he rose from the dead. Verse 38. Therefore, let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. That is the conclusion. All of us are sinners. All of us, we need forgiveness of sins. That is salvation. Only through the name of Jesus, only through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, only through him our sins will be forgiven. So either to believe in him and accept him as your Lord, as your Savior, as your King, and you will be forgiven, or those who reject him, as St. Paul will say right now, actually, they will not enjoy this salvation. They will not enjoy this forgiveness of sins. So now he is telling them, therefore, let it be known to you. Don't argue about it. It's either you accept him or reject him. Let it be known to you, brethren, that through this man, through the Lord Jesus Christ, is preached to you the forgiveness of sins. And by him, by the Lord Jesus Christ, everyone who believes is justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. After the fall of Adam and Eve, God gave the law to Israel. And he asked them, if you keep the whole law, you will be justified. But nobody was able to keep the whole law. That's why nobody was justified by the law of Moses. Then for the Gentiles, those who did not actually believe in Moses, they had the natural law, the conscience, and nobody was justified also, or was able to be justified by the natural law. And actually, this is what's written in Romans. The main message of the letter to Romans is about justification. So in Romans chapter 1, St. Paul spoke about the Gentiles. And he was questioning about the natural law. Whether the natural law was able to justify anybody, he said no. What about the law of Moses? Was the law of Moses able to justify anybody? No. So now we came to this conclusion that either the Jews or the Gentiles, everybody needed a Savior. And we are justified by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. We are justified by his grace, by the grace of God. That's why he is telling them, you who trust in the law, without the blood of Jesus, you cannot be justified. You who trust in the natural law, without the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, you cannot be justified. So, everyone who believes in him, who accepts him, who follows his way, will be justified from all things from which you could not be justified by the law of Moses. So those, the Jews who are insisting to reject the Lord Jesus Christ, he's sending them a serious message. If you continue to reject the Lord Jesus Christ, you will not be justified. That's why he concluded his preaching or his sermon by a warning. Warning in verse 4. Beware therefore, lest what has been spoken in the prophets come upon you. Now he is giving them a warning, and this warning is written in Habakkuk, chapter 1, verse 5. This warning in Habakkuk, chapter 1, verse 5. And as you know, many verses can refer to more than one thing. So this warning actually primarily was written about the invasion of the Chaldeans. But St. Paul used the same verse to apply it to those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ. What is this warning? Behold, you despisers, you who despise my name, you who reject my salvation, you who despise my blood that I shed on the cross. Behold, you despisers, marvel and perish. If you don't accept my blood, if you reject the grace of salvation, then you will marvel and perish. For I work a work in your days, a work which you will by no means believe, though one were to declare it to you. And this work, actually, when he comes in his second coming, and those who believed in him, he will put them on his right hand and tell them, come, you blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom that's prepared for you before the foundation of the world. But those on his left hand, he will tell them, depart from me, evildoers. To where? To the fire which is prepared for Satan and his soldiers. So the fire is not prepared for us. It's the kingdom of heaven is prepared for us. But the lake of fire is not prepared for us. But those who despised the grace of God, those who despised his salvation, then they will marvel and perish. Why they will marvel? Because they did not expect this. Like the Jews until today, they believe that they will be saved through the law of Moses, although they rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. So on the day of his second coming, they will be surprised, amazed. They will marvel. And they did not expect this work. But God actually has warned them in Habakkuk, and he told them, a work which you will by no means believe. Because until now, the Jews believe that they will be saved by the law of Moses. Though one were to declare it to you, although it was declared to you, but you rejected it and despised. This is actually the end of the sermon of St. Paul. Then, how the people reacted to this sermon? Verse 42. So when the Jews went out of the synagogue, the Gentile begged that these words might be preached to them the next Sabbath. The Gentiles were so happy to hear that the word of salvation is for them too. God would accept them. They are now the chosen people of God. They are not, you know, the structure of the temple. There was a court outside the temple. It's called the court of the Gentiles. The Gentiles were not allowed to enter into the temple because they were considered rejected. So now the Gentiles were very, very happy that an apostle, a Jewish apostle, St. Paul, who is a Pharisee, now St. Paul is telling them, the word of salvation is for you. If you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, you will be saved. That's why they begged Paul to come next Sabbath and to tell them more about this preaching. It is really the gospel of salvation, the glad tidings, the joyful news of the gospel. Verse 43, now when the congregation had broken up, many of the Jews and devout proselytes followed Paul and Barnabas, who speaking to them, persuaded them to continue in the grace of God. So some Jews who believed in the Lord Jesus Christ followed Paul and Barnabas. And some devout proselyte. What does mean proselyte? Proselyte means Gentiles who converted to Judaism. In Arabic, الهي الدخيل, دخلاء. يعني واحد دخل اليهودية. واحد أممي دخل اليهودية. Proselyte. So, proselyte means people who were Gentiles, but they converted to Judaism. So this devout proselyte also believed in the Lord Jesus Christ and followed Paul and Barnabas, who speaking to them, during the whole week, they were speaking to them and persuaded them to continue in the grace of God, to accept the grace of salvation, and to continue in this, not to reject it. And after 1 week, on the next Sabbath, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. Because I'm sure Paul and Barnabas, they were working during the whole week, preaching and persuading people. And also the Gentiles spoke to people about the glad tidings, now we are accepted. And the Jews and the devout proselyte also, they were calling people to come. So the following Sabbath, when they went to the synagogue, almost the whole city came together to hear the word of God. Who became jealous? Who became full of envy? But when the Jews saw the multitudes, they were filled with envy. And contradicting and blaspheming, they opposed the things spoken by Paul. The Jews actually were disappointed because of two things. Number one, the resurrection of Christ. Any person who was eyewitness and testified for the resurrection of Christ, he made the Jews disappointed and upset. And number two, that the Gentiles will be saved. These are the two main things actually that upset the Jews and made them full of envy. That's why they were contradicting St. Paul. Contradicting St. Paul, they told him, your interpretation of the prophecies are wrong. And blaspheming, they are rejecting the Lord Jesus Christ and rejecting the grace of God. And they opposed the things spoken by Paul. Then Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, now a confrontation must happen. So now Paul and Barnabas will confront the Jews. Confront them with what? In the beginning, the Lord Jesus Christ, when he sent the disciples, he told them, don't go to the city of Samaria. Don't go to the Gentiles. Go to the lost sheep of Israel. So the word of salvation first was addressed to Israel. As we read in John chapter 1, he came to his own, but his own rejected him. So when actually they rejected the word of salvation, then they started to go to the Gentiles. That's what St. Paul confronted them with. Verse 46, then Paul and Barnabas grew bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you first. So the Jews were the target of the word of salvation first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, he's warning them here. If you reject the word of salvation, as if you say, we are not worthy of the eternal life, we will not inherit the eternal life, then behold, we turn to the Gentiles. We turn to the Gentiles. And St. Paul wants to tell them, these are not my words, but even God in the Old Testament told you this. Verse 47, for so the Lord has commanded you. Commanded you where? Actually, this is in Isaiah 49, verse 6. Isaiah 49, verse 6. I have set you as a light to the Gentiles. So, who is the light? Jesus Christ. So the Father saying to the Son, I have set you a light to the Gentiles, that you should be for salvation to the ends of the earth, not only to the Jews. So St. Paul is telling them, these are not my words. Why are you angry at me? It's written in Isaiah that the Lord Jesus Christ, the Messiah, will be light to the Gentiles. And the salvation will be to the ends of the earth, not only for the Jews. Now we have two groups. The Gentiles, when they hear this, they will be more happy and they rejoice greatly. But the Jews, not those who believed, but the prejudiced Jews, actually, they will be disappointed and so angry. And that's the reaction that we'll see in the rest of the chapter. When the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and glorified the word of the Lord, that now we are saved. Now we are his people. Now we are his beloved. Now we are called for salvation. And as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed. So who became happy? The Gentiles and all those who had been appointed to eternal life. Some people, some denomination knew this word to speak about predestination. And they say that God predestined, appointed some people for salvation. So if you are among these appointed people, the elect, then you will be saved no matter what. And if you are not among those people who are appointed by God, then you will not be saved no matter what. But of course, this is a wrong interpretation of the dogma of predestination. And when you read the whole scripture and you see the tradition and how these verses are interpreted, it is completely wrong. Because God actually appointed everybody, the word of salvation is for everybody. But those who believe and those who will accept, they will be saved. But those who reject and despise the word of God will not be saved. So when St. Paul said, and as many as had been appointed to eternal life believed, he said, we can read it in a different way. And those who believed became appointed to eternal life. So it is based on their acceptance of the word of salvation, now they will inherit the eternal life. But the word of salvation is for everybody. Because the dogma of predestination, that God predestined certain people, this is against the justice of God. As if God has partiality, as if God has bias toward a certain group. And if God didn't have bias even to Israel, he said about Israel, Israel, my firstborn son. If God doesn't have bias or partiality toward Israel, so how can God appoint certain people to be the elect and other people will not be saved? Verse 49. And the word of the Lord was being spread throughout all the region. In spite of the persecution, in spite of the opposition, in spite of the contradiction, in spite of the blasphemy, the word of God will spread. And this happened from the time of the Lord Jesus Christ until now. The church all over this generation faced so many persecution, but all this persecution never stopped the word of God from being spread all over the world. Verse 50, but the Jews stirred up the devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from the region. Some of the historians said that the women in Antioch of Pisidia were very influential. That's why the Jews stirred up the devout and prominent women, the devout Jewish women, and the chief men of the city, most probably their husbands. And actually, they raised persecution against Barnabas and Paul to expel them from the city. And actually, they were able to expel them from the city, but they were not able to expel the word of God from the city. And later on, Paul returned to Antioch of Pisidia again. Verse 51, but they shook off the dust from their feet against them and came to Iconium. The Lord said to the disciples, if you go to a city and they reject you, shake off the dust from your feet. So actually, Paul and Barnabas did this literally to tell them, if you reject the word of God, then actually you judge that you are unworthy of eternal life. And they left. And here actually, they teach us a very important lesson. If there is an opposition in a certain place, I should not waste my time there. There are many, many fields are ready for harvest. So I can leave this place and go to another place. This actually happened with the Lord Jesus Christ himself when he went to a city of Samaria and they rejected him. John and James told him, Lord, let us pray and let us ask that God send fire to destroy this city. He told them, no, the Son of Man did not come to condemn the world, but to save the world. And what he did, he went to another city. You know, I remember one of the stories when the Sunday school movement started in the 50s. Then actually, some clergy at that time, they were oppositional to the Sunday school movement. And actually, they used to close the doors in front of the Sunday school teachers. So a group of the servants who were not allowed to serve in the church went to Pope Kyrillos, who was at the time Abuna Amin al-Mutawahid, and they complained to him that the priests actually are closing the doors in front of them and they cannot serve or do the Sunday school. So the Pope Kyrillos, this story was mentioned by Abuna Salib Suryal in his recordings about the church, the history of Sunday school. So Pope Kyrillos told them, yes, the Lord said, the harvest is few and the laborers are many. He actually reverses the verse. He is telling them, now actually you don't have place to see the harvest. Actually the harvests are plentiful and the laborers are few. And he told them, if the church gates are closed before you, go to the villages. And this actually was the beginning of the service in the villages. And how here actually, when God allows one door to be closed, actually to send them to another areas. And now actually the service in the village is a very, very important service in any city. So here, when they found persecution, opposition, they left Antioch of Pisidia and went to Iconium. Verse 52, and the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. The disciples at the Antioch of Pisidia. And as I told you, they were able to expel Paul and Barnabas, but they were not able to expel the word of God or the Holy Spirit or the disciples or the joy and happiness that was in their hearts. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.